Over 700 years before Christ, the prophet Isaiah declared many details of his birth, ministry, and death.
Today, Dick, you'll share about the names given to Christ by Isaiah and why they're so powerful.
Then later, we will share communion on the set and invite you to partake with us.
Stay with us for our special Christmas edition of Lifeline Today.
Welcome to Lifeline Today. This is our special Christmas edition, and in fact, this is going to air, the first airing, on Christmas Eve, which is a very special night, a very special celebration for us who celebrate the birth of Christ and also serve Him all year long. And so we want to just acknowledge that today, and we're going to receive communion together in the program just so that we can remember the importance of what has happened, the importance of His coming to earth and the change that has made to us individually, of course, but to the change He makes for the eternity. And we're thankful for that. Today, I want to share from Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. This is one of those verses that everybody recognizes, you know, and it's very often quoted during the Christmas season. It's Isaiah 9, 6, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder, and his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." You know, this is one of those verses that is astounding because it's 700 years before Christ is even born that Isaiah is giving these kinds of details. And incidentally, Isaiah is one of those books in the Bible that is the most frequently quoted, actually, in the New Testament. In fact, there are over 25 full quotations of Isaiah, and it's accredited to Isaiah in the New Testament. But there are probably more prophecies about Messiah in this book than any other book in the Old Testament as well. And that's what makes it such a special book, makes Isaiah such a special prophet, really. We actually understand details of Christ's coming and His ministry just from the book of Isaiah, even more than the New Testament in some ways. And so this is another interesting factor in this particular verse, is that Isaiah takes time to mention his names. You know, in the Old Testament, particularly in the Old Testament and in Jewish culture, names are very intentional. You know, in our culture, we just kind of give people names because we like the name. But in that time, they gave a name because it said something about destiny and purpose in that person's life. For example, Abraham. In fact, that wasn't his first name. Abram was his first name, and then the Lord changed his name to Abraham, which means the father of a multitude. See, there was destiny and purpose in that name. And so that is something that we need to recognize about Jesus, and in this verse, giving him these names is very intentional. You know, there's 117 different passages in the Bible that give names or entitlements to Jesus Christ. In fact, he probably has more names and entitlements than any other person in the scripture, period. And that says something as well. But you know, some of the examples are not just names, but Lion of Judah, Dayspring, Redeemer, the Alpha and the Omega. These are just a few of the names that give descriptions of Messiah. This is really important for us to realize because as we study the life of Christ, particularly now as we celebrate His birth and His coming to earth, this means so much to us. It tells us about what He is, who He is, why He came, and what that means to our lives. Look at the first thing that's said here. It says, "Unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given." This is clearly a reference to Christ, because many children have been born. But this one is particular. It says, "Unto us a child is born." Colossians 1:18 says, "For it pleased the Father that in Him all the fullness should dwell." Jesus came as the fullness of God the Father, the full expression of God in the form of a child. That is really something when you think about that, isn't it? That the Messiah would come in the form of a baby. And of course, we know some of the circumstances around His birth, and there was tremendous miraculous events like angelic choirs and those kinds of events. But more than that, we also understand that He was born of a virgin. And then it says, the government shall be upon his shoulder. When Christ came, he came with supreme authority. Philippians 2, 9, verse 11, 9 to 11 says, therefore God has also highly exalted him and given him a name above every other name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow and every tongue confess. Isn't that amazing? This is the destiny of all the earth. Every knee will bow. Every tongue will confess. This is just a matter of fact. Now, here's the wonderful thing. You can do this today willingly, and it will give you salvation. There are those who won't do this willingly, and of course, then there's consequences for that. So, continue on, and it says, then his name shall be called. This is what Isaiah says. And first of all, in Acts, it says that, that his name is a, such a special name. It says, nor is there salvation in any other, for there is no name, no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. That's pretty exclusive. It says there is no other name. There's just no other name. Because, you know, I've heard different philosophies. People say, well, you know, if you just do right, or if you do this, or if you try to be a good person. But the Bible is very exclusive when it comes to this point. It says there is no other name given to men in heaven and earth for which they can be saved. This is the name of Christ. That's the only entry into salvation through the person of Jesus Christ. Well, look at his names. Wonderful Counselor. You know, the full Hebrew meaning of this means actually wonderful in purpose, matchless in counsel and wisdom. You know, Jesus said this about himself in John 6:62. He said, the words that I speak are spirit and life. You know, the power of Christ's words were felt by those who experienced his ministry in those 3 years, those very short, really 3 years, where he ministered in his ministry on earth in Jerusalem and in the region. And it says the words he spoke, people were drawn to him because there was something spiritual and filled with life in the words that he spoke. Then notice it says he shall be called this, the Mighty God. Now that is really an interesting statement, because there are those who try to say that, well, Jesus isn't the Mighty God. He's just a, you know, a created being or an angel, and or maybe just the Son of God, like humans are the Son of God. But this doesn't leave us that option. It says he is the Mighty God. He is the only one. You know, it says in Colossians 2:15, it says that he has disarmed principalities and powers. He made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it. That means that he is complete and totally victorious, the Mighty God. And then notice this reference, he shall be known as the Everlasting Father. You know, literally this word in the Hebrew means the Father of eternity, or we could interpret it this way, the author of eternal life. You know, humanity had no hope. That is true of all of humanity on the planet. In terms of eternity, there was no hope. But it was Jesus who becomes the author of eternal life. And in this reference in the Hebrew, the Father of eternity. He opened the doors of eternity for all of humanity. You know, this is why we celebrate Christ and during this Christmas season. And let me just urge you to keep Christ in Christmas. There are so many other things that distract us, but this one thing we need to focus on. He is the Father of eternity. He's the one that opened the door to salvation. Colossians 1:16 says, all things were created by him, for him, and through him, visible and invisible. That's amazing. Whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, these are all created by him, through him, and for him. And then notice verse 17, it says, and he is before all things, and in him all things exist. My goodness, that is about as exclusive and inclusive as you can imagine. There is no, well, Jesus is just a good person here. This passage in Isaiah makes it clear who he really is. And then it says he is the Prince of Peace. He will bestow the fullness of shalom. Shalom is the word in Hebrew for peace. But shalom means more than we understand the word peace. We usually understand it as calm, you know, just a quiet or restful. But peace in the Hebrew word means health to the sin-sick soul, physical health to the body. It means healing between the sinner and God. It means healing between men, man unto man. There's healing in relationships. And it also means prosperity. So, and Isaiah 7:14 says this, "Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son and shall call his name Emmanuel." Emmanuel means God with us. God is with us. Jesus is not just some other person. He's not just some other human. He is God with us. And as I said, his entitlements give us a very clear picture of just how great he truly is. And then Isaiah says, "And the increase of his government, there shall be no end. There are no limitations upon the kingdom and its jurisdiction under the lordship of Jesus Christ." That is an amazing, amazing statement when you think of it. And it says, goes on to say, that he will be upon the throne of David and over his kingdom to order it and establish it with judgment and justice from that time forward, even forevermore. And then notice it says, "And the zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this." You know, the word zeal in the Hebrew is the same word that we use for passion. In fact, it could be considered romantic passion. This is a strong reference. It says the zeal of the Lord has performed this. You know, a very famous person who's passed away a long time ago, but her name was Corrie ten Boom. One thing she said, because we very important as we celebrate Christmas and we think about the birth and the coming of Christ to earth. She said, "If Jesus had been born 1,000 times in Bethlehem and not in me, then I would still be lost." That's an important point, isn't it? Now, I shared a lot about how amazing this person Jesus is and just how his names give him such clear reference to his greatness. He's just not someone else. He is someone so great, someone so wonderful, and not now only, but forever and ever. And you and I get to share this with him. But if he's not born into our own heart, you know, the word born again means actually literally born from above. That means the person of Christ through the Holy Spirit needs to come into our lives, and then you really have a true Christmas. That's when we really understand what Christmas means. Why don't you do that today? You could call our prayer line and say, "I'm receiving Christ during this Christmas season. I'm making him Savior and Lord." That would be the most wonderful Christmas gift you could ever imagine receiving. Do it right now.
You're invited to join Dick and Joan at Dominion Conference Ottawa, February 15th to 17th. This will be a strategic time to seek the word of the Lord for Canada in 2019. Special prophetic guests include Craig Broker and Samuel Robinson, along with co-hosts Evangelist Bill Prankard, founders of the National House of Prayer, Rob and Fran Parker, and facility hosts Pastor Jonathan and Tara Hutchison of Peace Tower Church in Ottawa. Anointed praise and worship music, along with personal ministry, will make this a must-attend event this winter. God has declared that he will have dominion from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth. Now is the time to seek God and release his word for the spiritual destiny of Canada. Together, we will make a supernatural impact on the future of this country right in the heart of the nation's capital. Registration is complimentary. However, you must pre-register online at dominionconference.com or phone 587-425-5730. Dominion Conference Ottawa, February 15th to 17th. It's Canada's time.
Isaiah 9:2 says, "The people who walk in darkness will see a great light. For those who live in a land of deep darkness, a light will shine." That prophecy was fulfilled on that first Christmas day 2,000 years ago. Are you and your family living in deep darkness? Jesus is the light of the world. Jesus is a light for your world. He's a light for you. Do you know him as personal Savior? Now is the time. Today, the Bible says, is the day of salvation. What better time for you to give your life to Jesus than right now in this Christmas season? Give your life to Jesus. He gave his life for you. That's why he came. Will you give your life to him? give us a call here in the prayer center. We'd love to help you pray through to that relationship with Jesus. Give us a call right now.
You know, just thinking about what Jill just said, and there's another scripture in Isaiah. We're all quoting from Isaiah today, and that obviously, again, shows you just how profound that prophet was. But there's another prophecy in Isaiah 16. It talks about gross darkness that's on the earth. And there will be a time when there's gross means massive, pervasive darkness, which I think we could say is in our age. And it says, but also the glory of the Lord will shine upon you.
Yes.
That there will be also great light when
great
there's
light
great darkness.
Great light and great darkness.
And, you know, Joan, at Christmas, you know, we use the lights. There's lights on this set, and they're symbolic of the fact that Jesus was the light of the world. That's why we use them in the Christmas celebration, the candles, the lights on the tree, and all this. It's all symbolic of His light coming into a dark world.
Yeah.
And, of course, the darkness we talk about is the fact that mankind is fallen, that they have fallen from the original position that God created man to be. And Jesus came to restore us. And so He came as the light of the world to restore us out of that darkness. Today we're going to receive communion. I'm going to invite you to go into your kitchen or wherever you are and get some elements. You can get some crackers or juice, whatever you like to use. But we're going to receive communion together.
Yeah.
And you know, Joan, communion was a command given directly by Jesus to His disciples. And then He said, do this in remembrance of me. You know, that's an interesting thought. He wants us to remember over and over again what He did for us, isn't it?
And it's like a prophetic act. Every time we do it, Dick, we remember what Jesus did. And it makes a statement in the spiritual realm too,
and
doesn't it?
Paul said that when he wrote to the Corinthians. He said these words. He says, as often as you do this, you proclaim the Lord's death until He comes. And so it is a proclamation. Mm-hmm. It's a declaration. And this is why it's so important. Well, here on Christmas Eve, whatever you're doing, if you're celebrating, really what we ought to be doing is reflecting upon the Lord and what He's done for us. We ought to make time for that. In fact, that's what Christmas is. It's a Christ Mass.
Mm-hmm.
The Mass was a celebration to remember Christ, and that's why it became known as Christmas. And so we're going to read this scripture, and it's from, again, the 1 Corinthians chapter 11. And this is Paul in verse 23. For I received from the Lord that I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when He was betrayed, took bread. And when He had given thanks, He broke it and said, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, He also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until He comes. You know, it's interesting that Jesus gave this command directly to His disciples, and it's recorded in the Gospels. But then Paul says he received it by revelation.
Yeah.
He said the Lord showed him this. Well, this is interesting. That means the emphasis of communion, when it needs to be understood, that Jesus specifically told His disciples, but then also made this revelation to Paul. And I know that most Christians understand how significant this is. And I hope you have your communion elements ready. And again, it doesn't have to be anything. It's bread and juice just to celebrate. But the bread, the word scripture says, represents His body. In my hand is a piece of matzo bread, which is traditionally used in the Passover. Of course, Jesus was the fulfillment of the Passover. And He said, He took this type of bread. He said, broke it. And He said, take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This matzo bread represents Christ perfectly because it's unleavened bread, which means without sin.
Mm-hmm.
And it's pierced because the Bible says He was pierced for our sorrows and our sins. And it's stripes because by His stripes we are healed. There's stripes on the matzo bread. And so He said, as often as you do this, and Joan, I'm going to ask you to take some bread as we get ready to receive the communion element together. You know, when we do receive the bread, it's a reminder that Christ is our strength.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's another reminder in this, that Christ's own body was crucified, yet rose from the dead. As we take this bread, it's a reminder that we too will rise from the dead, that we too one day will have a new body. and that body will be perfect, without sin, without pain, without sorrow. I know I'm talking to some people who probably have some pain, some sorrow, some sickness. Think about it. Your destiny is to have a body that will never be broken, a body that will never have pain, a body that will never have disease, a body that will never have any difficulty, any pain, sorrow along with it.
Yeah.
So let's take this together, and is it at home? I want you to take this that we receive in representation of the body of Christ. Let's receive together. I like what the scripture says that we just read in 1 Corinthians 11, that in the same manner he took the cup. In other words, he was being very deliberate. He took the bread in it. They were actually having a meal together, the Passover meal. But when he was in the Passover meal, he was deliberate. And he took aside the bread and broke it, and then he took the cup in the same manner and said, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood." You know, the covenant word is the strongest agreement one can have between God and man. It's an unbreakable covenant. And so he said, "This is the new covenant in my blood." His blood was shed, and in heaven we're told his blood was sprinkled on the mercy seat, and the Father on his throne said, "It is enough."
Yeah.
Every sin, every pain, every sorrow was paid for. You know, Joan, it's important to remember in this time, in this special night, that God has pardoned every human being.
That's right.
But the thing about a pardon, it has to be received.
That's right.
And this is why we celebrate communion, to remind ourselves we've received the pardon. And so today, as we receive the cup, remember, this is our pardon. Let's partake together. Right now, I want you to just open your hearts as Ryan and Alyssa minister with a very special song, "O Holy Night."
Stars are brightly shining. It is the night of the dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining, till he appeared and the soul fell. Shall cease. Sweet hymns of
Thank you, Ryan and Alyssa. You know, we only have a minute left to close the program. We want to wish you a very merry, very merry Christmas during this season.
Yes, and you know, Dick, I'm thinking of so many people who are gathering together as families. And you know, sometimes that can be a real contentious time, and I've felt that in my spirit. I just want to speak the peace of God over you and over your home. I like how you read that, Dick. He is called the Prince of Peace, and it comes from the word shalom, nothing missing, nothing broken. I just release that over your homes in Jesus' name, and we wish you a wonderful, love-filled Christmas.
Amen. You know what? Our prayer is that in 2019, you will experience the fullness of shalom.
Yes, amen.
You know that we're looking for God to do great things in our lives and in our nation in this coming year. Yeah. God bless you this day, and thank you again for tuning into the broadcast. Remember this, God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
See you next time.
Bless you. Bye-bye.
This program is supported by viewers like you, and we thank you for your partnership. We want to hear from you. Send us your prayer requests, praise reports, and comments on the program. Be sure to visit our website for up-to-date information or get in touch with us by email or phone. And don't forget to like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter. Dick and Joan are now available for conferences and events in your area. To book them for your event, call 587-425-5730 or email info@dickandjoan.com.